In a garden center, you may look for shade and sun plant sections, or saunter through the woody plants on your way to the vegetables. That's just one way we can divvy up the plant world. For a few minutes, we'll take a look at plants the way scientists look at plants. In order to understand the natural world, scientists have tried to organize and classify all living things. The broadest of the classifications is kingdom, and these categories include the plant kingdom, animal kingdom, and more. It may be you've learned about kingdoms in high school biology class and now find things look a bit different. Scientists continue to reorganize and reclassify what they find. New charts now have things organized into empires, and parts of the bacteria kingdom have split off to form their own. For our purposes, the kingdoms of plant, animals, fungi, and bacteria are mostly unchanged and will suit our needs for training. Each kingdom can be further subdivided into phylum, class, order, family, genus, and species. If you were a botany major, you'd pursue the study of these different levels of hierarchy. As this is a Master Gardener training program, we'll go about this studying in a very different and hopefully friendlier manner. What makes a plant a plant? One of the defining traits is that plants are able to make their own food through the process of photosynthesis. We'll talk about that later. Beyond that, there begins to be many characteristics that start to make plants different from one another. One way to look at it is by dividing our plants into those that reproduce by seeds and those that do not. Spore-producing plants, also known as bryophytes, have a very different reproductive life cycle from seed-producing plants. Our spore-producing plants have two very distinct stages to their reproductive cycle, one of which involves the exchange of genetic materials to form a new individual, and another stage that forms a spore of genetic material that is completely independent of the plant. For the life cycle must complete both of these phases, making it much more complex when compared to the angiosperms. Mosses, equisetum, horsetails, liverworts, and ferns are common spore-producing plants found in our gardens. You're probably most familiar with the seed-producing plants, as they are the vast majority of the things found in our gardens and landscapes. Flowering plants, otherwise known as angiosperms, undergo a reproductive cycle that involves the exchange of genetic material in an act we call pollination. The result is a seed. We'll talk more about plant sex later on. Gymnosperms exchange genetic material, as do our angiosperms, but the seeds produced are not enclosed in a fruit-like container or in a flower, but produced in structures we know as cones. Pines, spruces, firs, and others are cone-bearing. That's why we call them conifers. Jumping back to angiosperms, our flowering plants can be further divided into our broadleaf types, called dicotyledons, and our grass-like plants, called monocots. Cotyledons refer to the embryonic leaf that emerges first from the germinating seed. In monocot, there's one leaf that emerges. With dicots, there's two. Other ways of telling monocots apart from your dicots in your garden include flower parts and vascular arrangement. See your manual for more details on this topic. For our purpose of study, one of the most important reasons to know the difference between the two is in the selection of weed killers. Some of our herbicides will select for one and not the other, thus allowing our broadleaf weed killers to be useful when controlling for violets growing in our turf grass. In summary, plants can be classified in many ways. In the classification system we just skimmed through, we separated the seed-producing plants from the spore-producing plants. We then gave a very cursory overview of mosses, ferns, conifers, and angiosperms. I also talked about how the flowering plants are divided into those which are broadleafed and those that are grass-like. Now, I want to switch gears and talk about another way we can talk about the different types of plants. Plants with similar characteristics are grouped into families. Within a family are the different genera and species. We are familiar with many plant families in our gardens, the mint family, the rose family, the orchid family, the maple family, and there's many, many more. Scientists have grouped plants into hundreds upon hundreds of families, and like kingdoms, keep reorganizing things. Traditionally, families were created based on similar reproductive structures, such as the flowers and fruits. Leaf complexity and growth habit further helped group things apart or together. Today, DNA is being used to examine the relationships of plants and is one of the factors used for the reclassification of a plant from one family to another. In addition to physical or genetic similarities, plants within the same family often share the same susceptibility to insect and disease pests, or maybe many members produce the same toxic compounds. Becoming familiar with plant families is extremely helpful in the process of plant identification and diagnosing plant problems, but will take time and practice for you to develop. For example, the nightshade family, Solanaceae. Many species in this family are toxic. Flowers are with 4 to 5 sepals, usually fused together. The leaves are alternating along the stem, and the fruit is usually a berry. Sometimes it's a capsule. Members of this family include the weed nightshade, the ornamental Brugmansia, and our favorite garden crops such as tomatoes, eggplants, peppers, and potatoes. The mints are in the family Lamiaceae. The leaves are opposite, and the stems are usually square. Members of this family include ornamentals, culinary and medicinal herbs, and the weed Creeping Charlie. Rosaceae, or the rose family, includes over 2,800 species. The family includes many ornamentals and edibles, including plums, cherries, peaches, apricots, almonds, apples, pears, raspberries, strawberries, and many, many more. And obviously, it contains roses, as well as many other ornamental, herbaceous, and woody plants. This family is a great example of how a pathogen can be shared among its members. The bacteria causing fire blight is able to spread among many of the woody members, decimating orchards and specimen plants in the landscape. In the vegetable garden, do you rotate through your tomatoes and peppers, cole crops, cucumbers, and melons, planting each in a different spot in the garden each year? In doing so, you're rotating different plant families in order to avoid pest outbreaks. By understanding how scientists have organized plants, you may begin to improve your grasp of the variety of plant materials available. Also, by understanding why and how some plants are grouped according to their similarities, form, and function, we can begin to make decisions on the selection of appropriate materials for our landscapes, make correct pest management decisions, and quicken the identification process of an unknown plant. And don't worry, the more you're in the garden and working with plants, the easier recognizing plant families becomes.